life can dramatically change a planet. Make no mistake, life defines Earth. It happened here during the Great Oxygenation Event, where the advent of photosynthesis gave the atmosphere of Earth its oxygen, but only after contributing to rusting the free iron on its surface. Whenever you see rust on a car, that's the plants indirectly trying to eradicate it. This oxygenation event was deadly to much of the earliest life on Earth, which was forced to retreat into the depths of the planet to hold on. On the surface, it became the dominion of the plants, status quo that continues to this day. But the atmosphere we breathe is not the original atmosphere of this world. But Earth is not the only planet that has seen atmospheric changes, albeit for different reasons. We know that Mars once had a much thicker atmosphere and liquid water on its surface. This alone is interesting, even if Mars never spawned life. The idea that two rocky planets in our solar system had a period of being able to sustain liquid water, along with Venus as a potential third, coupled with a myriad ice shell ocean moons, strongly suggests that the most basic solvent of life must exist as a liquid everywhere in the universe, and very commonly. Indeed, we know that water ice is among the most common materials present in galaxies. We've always tended towards the view that if Mars once had life, maybe as it became increasingly hostile as it lost its atmosphere, that life may have retreated down into the planet's crust, as the anaerobic microbes did here to escape the poisonous oxygen. As such, it's been suggested that Mars may still host a subterranean biosphere, a remnant from a second abiogenesis of life in the solar system, or perhaps a cousin of life on Earth. And rather, abiogenesis may not have happened originally on Earth, but Mars, and was transported here through panspermia. But Mars and Earth have related but different histories. Geologically, Mars is much more difficult to study than Earth. We have a handful of Martian meteorites from generally unknown locations on that planet, so there isn't a good handle on context from those. And most of them are volcanic basalts, but not much else. That means that Mars's geology can only be studied from orbit and by geologically equipped rovers. What we can tell, however, is that Mars has gone through four major geologic periods, which are named after locations on Mars where evidence of them is to be found. The first has little evidence left, but almost certainly had to have happened in a specific way. It's called the pre-Noachian period and goes from about 4.5 billion to 4.1 billion years ago. Essentially, this is the period where Mars cooled enough to form a crust, but would have been subject to a very high, very intense impact and cratering rate. This period also seems to have seen the formation of a major feature of Mars, that its terrain essentially breaks down into two types, the northern lowlands and the southern highlands. Mars at this time would have had a very dense atmosphere created by the constant impacts releasing gases from the planet's interior along with water vapor that would have condensed into an ocean, but one that was very high temperature and held so by high pressure. This initial ocean may have even been global, but as that ocean cooled sometime around 4.4 to 4.3 billion years ago, the atmosphere continually escaped or was locked up geologically. And it is here we reach the point where life, hypothetically, could have gotten a start. This leads us to perhaps the most intriguing epoch of Martian geologic history, the Noachian, which runs from about 4.1 to 3.7 billion years ago. This period is named after a highland region known as Noachus Terra. This period still saw heavy bombardment. Indeed, this period saw Earth's late heavy bombardment. But we know from Earth that life somehow appeared during the late heavy bombardment, as dicey as it must have been in those days. Life arose on this world under conditions much worse than those that killed the dinosaurs. And a bombardment it was for Mars as well. The largest impact structures and basins on that world date from this period. And there was heavy volcanism going on in areas of the planet. And indeed, the famed Valles Marineris Canyon was formed during this period, which appears to be a huge crack or fissure in the surface, or at least started out as one. Volcanic activity releases gases, and that would have contributed to the atmospheric conditions of Mars at that time. This may also have been a time of rain on Mars. And indeed, many of the markers of the action of liquid water on the surface of Mars, such as valleys and apparent lake beds, are related to Martian rain. But this was also a time where Mars had both liquid water and dry land, resembling Earth. Mars would have also initially had a magnetic field so crucial for life on Earth, but this period also saw that dynamo shut down and thus the disappearance of that field. Even still, Mars would have conditionally been habitable for the duration of this age, but less so as time progressed. Next comes the Hesperian Age at 3.7 to 2.9 billion years ago. This age saw a drop in cratering rates, and somewhat of a drop in volcanism, but not by that much, with as much as 30% of the surface of Mars getting renewed by volcanic plains. The rain continued, but it was acidic, and created extensive sulfate deposits and overall altered surface geology. Temperatures plunged, and the planet's water began to freeze. But with abundant volcanic heat, this led to steam eruptions and massive transient flooding. And then it ended, and that's when life on the surface of Mars became unlikely. For completeness, the last and current era in Mars's geologic history is the Amazonian period, ranging from 2.9 billion years to now. This is the relatively inactive Mars we see today that preserves an extensive record of its past geologic history. This is the frozen desert Mars we're now so familiar with. Weathering is slow, mostly by wind, though it's thought that there may have been occasional periods of a warmer, wetter Mars that were short-lived due to changes in axial tilt and its orbit. In fact, even today, some observations seem to indicate that Mars is actually coming out of an ice age, and may see warmer temperatures in the future, but not by that much, and liquid water on the surface of Mars instantly boils away or freezes. Unless you somehow terraform it, the oceans of Mars are not returning. Early in this period, Mars saw late volcanism, even on Olympus Mons. And indeed, Mars may still occasionally be volcanically active to some degree, but whether there is still life holding out on Mars is an open question. But Mars hints that something may still be going on. In this regard, Mars has actually proven to be really mysterious. Hints of life first came in the form of the 1970s Viking-labeled release experiments, which were designed to detect soil microbes on Mars, essentially by dumping in some nutrients into a soil sample to see if anything ate it. Something did. Indeed, the experiment was verified across both landers. This question remains open, however, in that we can't know from the data whether we were seeing a chemical reaction mimicking metabolism or actual life. But this life would be very different if it exists, because it's so near the surface that it's hard to see anything resembling our life being able to live there. If Mars life exists, it seems a better bet to look deep rather than shallow. But the mysteries didn't stop there. In 2018, seasonal plumes of methane were detected on Mars. Methane can be formed geologically, but seasonally is a little bit harder to explain. Further, formaldehyde has been detected, which means that Mars is either more geologically active than we know, or it may hint at subsurface life. And there are still controversial findings in Martian meteorites that may hint at a biological origin, as they do somewhat resemble fossils. But there's a huge problem here. It may very well be that ancient life on Mars may have had no choice but to poison itself and cause its own self-extinction. The problem goes back to the beginning of this video. Life can change a planet's atmosphere. In Earth's case, it was for the better for the eventual rise of intelligent life with our oxygen-hungry brains, but ultimately not great for the anaerobic microorganisms. But that's Earth. Mars may have been in a sufficiently different boat where the changes to that world may have been worsened by the presence of life. A recent study paints a picture of Mars about 4 billion years ago. Life could have existed subsurface, consuming hydrogen and carbon dioxide, and producing methane as a byproduct, all while being protected by the Martian soil. As temperatures dropped, that life would have needed to retreat deeper and deeper to avoid the increasing cold. That mix of hydrogen, carbon dioxide, and methane, all heat-trapping gases, may have compounded the global cooling happening at Mars. This leads to a tale of two hypotheses in astrobiology. One is known as the Gaia hypothesis, and it's been around since the 1970s, first advanced by James Lovelock and Lynn Margulis. This hypothesis rests on the notion that life is self-regulating, and that life in general reaches a kind of equilibrium of maintaining environmental habitability on life-bearing worlds like Earth. So think of it like this. If you end up with too much carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it gets compensated for by increased plant growth and activity. As you can imagine, in recent years this idea has lost some favor, given that on this planet there is a giant elephant in the room altering any sort of natural equilibrium. human industrial civilization. The other is the Media hypothesis, and it's much more recent, advanced by Peter Ward in 2009. One can't help but be chilled by the naming of these two hypotheses. Gaia in Greek mythology is a personification of Earth as the ancestral mother of all life. Indeed, in the equivalent ancient Roman mythology, the name is Terra, as in Terrans of science fiction fame in many stories, or Terra Firma, etc. In contrast, Medea was a figure from Hesiod, granddaughter of Helios the Sun, figuring in the Jason and the Argonauts myth, and, in chilling contrast to Gaia, represents a mother that murders her own children. That name fits the Medea hypothesis unusually well for a scientific name based on the ancient Greeks. The idea is that life itself is inherently self-destructive, more than it is self-regulating. Ward pointed out that mass extinction events on Earth don't really look very self-regulating. The great oxygenation event certainly wasn't. It was really the opposite. It was life being its own worst enemy. Only through abundance and stability has life continued on here. But for Mars, that may not have been available, and a very different trajectory forced it down a different path. Though perhaps, as Earth's habitability reaches an end, it may see such a collapse as well. And while this work does not preclude the persistence of subsurface Martian life managing to hold on until today, it's not hard to imagine life running into problems the deeper it tries to retreat early in the history of Mars. Go too deep and it's too hot. Go too shallow and it all freezes. And thus wholesale extinction may occur so long as there aren't any conditions that offer a reprieve. All of this decline may have been partly precipitated by the presence of life on Mars. And that's one of the more spooky solutions to the Fermi Paradox. Most life is microbial, and it's inherently unstable and self-destructive on any worlds that aren't just perfect to sustain life long enough for the magic of complex life to happen. Remember, it took Earth nearly 2 billion years to make the leap from prokaryotic to eukaryotic life. Had the conditions of Earth not been stable enough for that to happen, almost 2 billion years of relative stability, Earth would have only ever been a planet of the simplest microbes. If that's the rule of the universe, then here's a scenario. Simple microbial life is common, it could be everywhere, but very transiently because it's inherently prone to self-extinction and poisoning its own environment. This could even extend to ice shell moons where the advent of life creates a noxious environment just by its chemistry. Only very lucky situational perfect planets like Earth can pull it off long enough for complexity to develop. Those tolerances would depend greatly on where in the habitable zone of a star a planet is, what conditions it presents, such as plate tectonics, and whether photosynthesis ever develops. And also the presence of a magnetic field that sustains rather than shuts down like that of Mars, but also the size of a planet. Like Mars, it can't be too small, but there's also an upper limit where it can't be too large, which is thought to be about 2 Earth masses for the super-Earths. So you're left with not just a Goldilocks zone around stars, but Goldilocks planets that can produce complex life. But then it needs to get to intelligence, which took Earth almost 4 billion years. Here we are, finally. But had anything happened in that long period of relative stability, had anything strayed just outside the parameters that allowed for us, whatever those may be, and we wouldn't be here. And then there's the question of our own future survival and avoidance of extinction as an intelligent species. This really starts looking like the Great Silence, doesn't it? Perhaps that Great Silence is what we should expect to see. And the ultimate solution to the question of are we alone boils down to a very simple answer. No, not always. But the natural result of when it happens is extinction, with very few exceptions from microbial life to civilizations. The great filter may simply involve the realities of life itself at its earliest stages, and from then on it's nothing but challenges to continue to exist. And someday, sooner or later, you no longer do. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently commenting about how that script certainly went unusually dark at the end. It's me, it happens, I'm an author, we do that. But never fear, there are always the immortal machine civilizations that nothing can destroy except the heat death of the universe. All it takes is one past civilization in the Milky Way to have developed that and sent it out von Neumann self-replicator style, and oh yeah, we've got something to interact with when we get out there. And now you see why I don't want to go to space, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.